My name is, as he said, Martin Wiesen, and I'm going to tell you something about water, or more about the lack of water. The General Assembly of the United Nations acknowledged that the right to clean and healthy water is one of the fundamental human rights. We heard about human rights from Mr. Kramer. You know, human rights, freedom to travel and stuff like that. Now water is as well a human right. Now, yes, it's since 1.5 months, it's water, clean water, a human right. A right, as we in the so-called first world would not consider that it is required. A right which we would not believe that it is necessary to be expressed additionally on our blue planet. Our blue planet, Mr. Hawks is not here anymore, it's a water planet. Life has developed within water, and till today it's one of the most important components of our organism. Drinking water is essential for our life. Unfortunately, it's a rare commodity, no matter how blue our planet might be. 70% of our planet are covered with water, but just 3% is fresh water. Of these 3%, Morro is located 1/2 mile below, or is ice, still ice. So, in fact, just 0.3% is available fresh water. In the 20th century, the world population has tripled. You can see, 1, 2, 3. But the water consumption has increased in this time, in this period, sixfold. It's not enough space to show it here right now. Okay, this was too fast. And on the problem is the increasing consumption worldwide. For example, an average inhabitant of the United States uses 300 liters water per day. In the EU, it's about 150 liters. And the others, so the so-called second or third world, just less than 10 liters. I even can see this chart. That's a problem. It's what a big problem. And the big, really big problem is the rapidly growing consumption in the emerging markets. This is not in these cases, like China, Brazil, or India. So you don't have to be a mathematical genius in order to realize that danger is in the offing. For example, in fact, 1 billion people have no access to drinking water, no access to safe drinking water. Another 1.5 billion has just limited access. Together, this is 2.5 billion people. This is more than 3 times more than the population of United States and EU together. They are drinking contaminated water, and contaminated water often causes diarrhea and other infections, which, if left untreated, often led to death. According to United Nations reports, 80% belong to this category, 80% of all this stuff. One thing is very problematic for me. Of all hospital beds in affected areas, are more than 50% occupied with people suffering from water-related diseases. Ladies and gentlemen, we are not talking about malaria or HIV, stuff we are reading every time, every day in the newspaper. We are talking here about simply water we are drinking here around. This is not only a human tragedy, but it's also a tremendous financial burden on the healthcare system of the respective countries. Second, we heard about it from Mrs. I don't know the name, sorry. Every 50 seconds, one child dies to the fatal symptoms caused by drinking polluted water. While you are listening at me, ladies and gentlemen, 70 more children losing their young lives of this same reason. And they're dying very young. In developing countries, 90% of the child mortality on diarrhea is under the age of 5 years. So the General Assembly of the United Nations has proclaimed not just only the human right, also the Millennium Development Goals, maybe you heard about it, in 2000. And one of these targets that are being pursued is extremely ambitious. Until 2015, clean water shall be made available to 1/2 of the people throughout the world, suffering from a shortage of uncontaminated drinking water. In figures, it means clean drinking water is made to be available to 125 million people every year. So this is the half of the population of the United States every year. This is not only a humanitarian and financial challenge. This is first of all a logistic problem. And therefore the question arises as a first question, to where we get all the water from and how can we successfully distribute it to the needy? The answer is, in my opinion, very easy. Not at all. It's not possible. It makes no sense to dig thousands of wells which would stop to function after a short while because of lack of maintenance. Moreover, it even makes less sense to bring water to the people, because it would lead to a kind of inertia and thus increase the dependency to the outside help. The only solution would be to put the responsibility into the hands of those whose health and life is endangered by polluted water. So it has to be their task to disinfect locally available water. At present, we know some disinfection stuff. Present most frequently used method is to cleanse water is to boil it. Everybody knows it. It's very easy. But this method has several negative aspects. A high energy input is required for boiling, mostly by using fuel, which is a scarce and costly raw material. The burning of fuel, and that's a very good topic, I think, per household, per day, and we are talking, ladies and gentlemen, we are talking about many million fireplaces every day, gives a rise to huge quantities of CO2 every day. In addition, open fireplaces ranks among to the 10 world's worst pollution problems. It's from the Blacksmith Institute and the Green Cross. Another widespread method is the use of chlorine tablets. You can see a very, very big tablet. This technique is applied by NGOs and other aid organizations. The major disadvantage of this source of this kind of disinfection is that tablets daily and thus becomes dependent on the supplier. They have to buy it or they receive it and are dependent on the supplier. And whenever no money is available, it means that water is not disinfected. Furthermore, chlorine tablets do not guarantee complete disinfection. For example, cryptosporidis. It's a kind of... Honestly... cryptosporidis, not as easy. And honestly, everyone who has ever tried chlorinated water, it tastes horrible. It's not very good. But, okay, now it's enough from bad messages. Let's ask, what can be done to clean available water and make the water drinkable very simple without huge costs? It's a very big issue. And a very good question, have the Swiss Federal Institute of Technology, its university, Zurich, called the ETH, has found many years ago a brilliant solution, very easy, and it's called the SODIS method. SODIS is abbreviation and stands for solar water disinfection, and it's that easy. You put just water, contaminated water, into a PET bottle, nothing more, put it into the sun for several hours, and you won't believe me, after some hours, it's disinfected. It's that easy. This sounds like the ideal solution, and it is, mainly because it's also propagated by the WHO since 10 years or something like that. Today, 3 million people uses SODIS, solar disinfection, on a daily basis. Wait a minute, just 3 million people? Why aren't this more? It's easy, it's cheap, it's very easy. The answer is easy as well. This is SODIS, and these are 2.5 billion people. To use SODIS, you need a certain amount of training to use it properly. And that's the problem. It's not possible to train 2.5 billion people. The user should know how long the process is for exposure into the sun to achieve the disinfected water. Moreover, there is a need for monitoring the whole process because weather conditions change or the places changes. One is in Bolivia, the other one is in Africa. It changes everywhere. The problem is, how should the users know at what point of the process their drinking water is safe for drinking, for consumption? And now here is coming the invention, the Wadi. Wadi is coming into very easy to put it onto a PET bottle. My approach to this is a very personal one. I love to travel. I was in Asia and South America and Africa and everywhere. And for many months and even years, and thus I'm aware of what is going on in these countries. And in these countries, so-called second or third world. And I realized there the challenges which are in the daily routine in these countries, in the developing countries, cannot be solved by our first world approach. This applies both to the mentality of the people and to the available resources. This, for instance, is a welding device. I was in Rwanda 2 months ago. This is a welding device. And I think this is a very good example how it works with locally know-how and locally resources. Actually, I just want to say we have to get the people to do it by themselves. Don't give them chlorine tablets. Don't give them stuff. They have to do it by themselves. I myself, for example, contracted cholera. You know cholera? I thought cholera is not even, it's not anymore here. From the way from Venezuela to Colombia. It wasn't a pleasure experience. I lost more than 10 kilos. And I cannot recommend this type of slimming diet. It's not very funny. And how I contract with cholera? Of course, with polluted water. Then 3 years ago, I read an article in the German magazine Spiegel, where the Solis method was described there along with the problems they have. So I called at the ETH. Solis is from the ETH. I called ETH and said to the people, "Hello, my name is Martin. I have a solution for your problem." And they said, "Ah, Martin, hey, we have been waiting for you for your call." Since years. Okay, it wasn't like that, but it was a very good work with them. And I said to them, okay, let's do it otherwise. We have to do it very simple, very clear, and very inexpensive. And first of all, I had planned to design a complete drinking water reactor for many people in cities, based on the Solis principle, a huge machine with pumps and tubes and stuff like that. But the more I discussed with the people from the ETH, the more apparent it became that this approach is going exactly into the opposite direction. The whole procedure of solar disinfection had to be easier and less costly. In other words, it had to be simple and it had to be affordable. Thus, the drinking reactor was omitted and the measurement unit retained. And this was the original model of the Wadi in theoretical stuff. Yet, where do we place this measurement unit? Of course, Solis is with PET bottles, of course, at a PET bottle. Why not? All our PET bottle is not environmentally friendly. That's not right. They're cheap. They're cheap. They are widely available, not easy to destroy, and very, very important, they can be used as often as possible in the course of their life cycle. And the easiest way of an attachment for a bottle is, of course, to screw it on. But it should function like a screw cap, so you can screw it on it. It's very easy. If you're interested in the technique in detail, I hope so. First of all, of course, the UV sensor who measures the relevant UV rays. UV rays disinfect the water. Second, it was very important to show the people the measurement results, and the results is with a display, and they have to understand this display. And we have developed our own display, which shows a smiley, and very sad smiley. And as soon as the water is clean, the smiley smiles. It's that easy. We tried it with green and red. So you can forget it. Smile is the best one. So if your bottle smiles at you, the water is ready to drink. That easy. And as a small reminder, we have designed pictograms, which are located on the device. Thus, we can also approach illiterates, and rare languages, which is an important issue, especially in the so-called third world. Last but not least, Wadi requires a power supply, and as disinfection, solar disinfection functions with the sun, it was obvious that we had to use the sun for energy production, of course, with a solar cell. Talking about development and production, great care was taken that the device have to be environmentally friendly. Very important. We used a cradle-to-cradle approach right from the beginning of the development work. And we profited knowing this principle, this cradle-for-cradle, from TED. Thank you. And namely by the speech by William McDonough, thanks at this point. The synthetic material is used, is 100% recyclable, electronic system as well, and as stated, there is no batteries, similar devices, or stuff like that. This guarantees after a life cycle of 5 years, you can put Wadi thrown away into the dustbin without worrying about it. Lo and behold, the first prototype was ready, and what it is? And that was the beginning of the 2009. If you know a little bit about development work, you know the really work started from now on. However, the best solution is of no use if no one knows about it. Hence, we have thought about several models as how we can best provide the device for the people who need it. And for one thing, we are learning from the wonderful project, as we heard about today, is one laptop per child. We want to finance Wadi with a similar model. For those who don't know what I'm talking about, the one who buys one laptop per child donates another one. And simple, we want to give this to Wadi. Moreover, we are facilitating commercial integration via sponsoring or donations. This works because Wadi will be available with 100% different branding or advertising around it. So making financial possibility. But I don't want to go into the financial aspects because we are convinced about another thing, very important thing. Namely that we must include those who are affected by the polluted water. And so, furthermore, we have many contacts with small dealers in respective countries who want to sell Wadi on the street. They want to sell Wadi on the street and establishing a supporting leg for themselves. For this purpose, we offer a commission to the dealers like the very common microcredit right now. And this is a part of added value remains in the countries, in the respective countries, to have it there. There is another version of Wadi, I hope it's enough time for it. It's in a great interest for me personally, and so Wadi can be part of a first aid box. Or first aid packages, which can guarantee the supply of clean water in case of natural diseases like floods or earthquakes, along with other stuff like blankets, life-saving utensils, and so on. Just imagine one thing. We can know all these pictures from the television. Imagine no more hundreds and thousands of people standing in a line, waiting daily near the trucks, where helpers hand out mechanically disinfected water. Every day, daily. They might receive one of these Wadi just once and then it could clean their own water. And please do not forget that 1 billion people have no access to clean water, no access to clean drinking water, and we have to take responsibility. We have to give to these people all over the world a possibility that will make them self-sufficient. That's the really important thing, self-sufficient in obtaining safe drinking water. And my opinion, you will see, water is becoming the new oil.
modest thing for life. Thanks for your kind attention.